years ago, I think I met Johnson. He was recommended to me to come and preach in Melbourne. He was recommended by a man by the name of Henri Okinola, who's actually going to be preaching here July 22nd. And just a wonderful man. And so Johnson pulled me up and he said, "Kevin, I think you better meet me before I come teach in your church." And so I came to Saskatoon, and I think that was in about September or October or something like that. And so I went to his apartment, and wouldn't you know, we spent hours together that day, and just a kindred spirit and grace. And you know, I didn't know you all here tonight, except Jake. I knew Jake, and I knew my sister, and I knew my brother-in-law. But they were going somewhere else, all right? So I didn't know anybody else in this grace message except Lonray, and that's an interesting story in itself. Johnson, when he got to Saskatoon, he's lived at Lonray's for a couple of months, and they started this grace group, and they were starting grace together, and we talked about, wouldn't it be great if we started a church in Saskatoon? And we were thinking 1 or 2 years later, it was months, just like 3 or 4 months later when we started Grace Life Center. And so over the years, Johnson has been an integral part to me personally. And I don't know if anybody's gonna miss Johnson as much as me, because I just love this brother with all my heart. And that's why I know that God is not calling him to Toronto. Like Jonah, Johnson is going into the belly of the whale. No, I'm just kidding. And so tomorrow, they've got the movers coming. And to be honest, I don't even know. Johnson, maybe you can share with us what job you're even taking over there. Because I know we've talked that you're working over there, but I don't even know where you're working or anything like that. I'm sure it's in IT. Johnson, why don't you come? And so last night, Johnson said, "Kevin, I'm going to be in church tomorrow night." So I texted him back and I said, "Well, do you want to preach tomorrow night one last time to us?" He may be back in Saskatoon and preach to us again sometime, but before he leaves. And I said, "Yeah." I don't know. He said yes. No, actually, he said, "I'm on the phone right now. I'll get back to you." and he said, "Yeah, I'd like to do that." So Johnson, why don't you come? And man, I love you, brother. I just this is a good guy, and so amen.
Amen. Welcome, everyone, and it's good to be back home. Let me tell you, no matter where I go, this place remains home for me. I'm telling you, I feel the love and the honor and the love of God that binds us together here. I mean, I've worked with Kevin for almost 3.5 years, and I've never met a pastor that is so caring like him. I'm telling you. I've worked with several pastors, so he's pastor at another level. And I told him, he's still my pastor. No matter where I go, I'm still connected. And I watch some of the services online as well, so I'm still connected. If this church needs me anytime, they call me, I'm coming. Okay. If you are doing a program, I'm coming. So I'm not going. And I'm extending God's grace wherever I'm going. You know, I'm carrying this message anywhere I'm going. So Kelvin, don't worry, you'll come to Toronto to come and preach there, because this gospel must go to everywhere. And I'm telling you, God is going to send some of us to places that, I mean, they need to hear the gospel. So don't be afraid when God says it's time to move. So he said, I didn't say what I'm doing and where I'm going, where I'm working. Okay. So maybe in 1 minute. So yeah, earlier this year, I mean, me and Kevin, we have a coffee time, right? In Tim Hortons. And you know, for me, for almost 10 years, I've sensed that God wants me to do ministry. Okay, when I was doing my PhD in South Africa, One morning after I woke up, the Lord said that I've called you to take the gospel into the hands of the heart for me. And he specifically spoke to me that when you leave Saravika, you are going to Canada. Now, I didn't know Saskatoon. I didn't know where Saskatchewan is. But I'm just coming. I picked one bag. I'm just coming. I got in here. Somebody said, where are you going? I said, Saskatoon. He said, what? Saskatoon? You won't survive there. I said, why? He said, it's too cold. I said, don't worry. If it's cold, I won't come out. I didn't know that. I'm joking. So I came in, and for almost 8 years, we've been here. And I've been blessed to meet a lot of wonderful people, a lot of interesting people, a lot of loving people and caring people. Now, I'm a computer scientist by training, but you see, ultimately, I know that my goal is to do God's work, ultimately. So there are so many opportunities that I've seen that I didn't follow. Why? Because for me, I'm not just driven by by opportunities, I'm driven by purpose, which I'm very clear about. So this year, early this year, me and my wife, we have a sense that God wants us to do ministry in Ontario. We don't really know specifically. In fact, originally I was looking at Ottawa. So I'm just trusting God that, well, it will open a door for us to move and probably do what he wants us to do. So there is a work that I was trying to do in Nigeria for the past 2 years. I would travel to Nigeria almost 3 times and then meet some people, work on some projects. But some of the projects didn't really go too far. But there is a specific one that I was trying to do with a bank in Nigeria in October last year, a work, an IT work. So that work, the person that contacted me for the work said this is what they want, and I was working on it. But eventually, they didn't award the contract to me eventually, but I did some work to show them how the thing's supposed to work. So I didn't know that God was using that project to actually set me up for something else. So I did the work for almost 2 months and no pay, because eventually I didn't get the contract. So around March of this year, as I was contemplating where is God taking us, especially for ministry. So this bank, one of the banks in Canada, TD Banks, just give me a phone call. Said, do you have any projects that you have done in this particular area? We are looking for a consultant company that can work with our head office on this particular project. I said, wow, exactly the work that I did for the bank in Nigeria that I was not paid for 2 months was what we were looking for. They only gave me 4 days to come in and show them what I have, and then if they are happy with it, then we can sign a deal. In 4 days, what can you do? Well, let me tell you, everything that happens in your life counts, especially when you are led by God. God can use the slightest thing that you consider you waste time on, it's a mistake, to bring his glory out. So they asked me to come and make a presentation. And I went to the head office in Toronto. I met the manager. They have a meeting, and then they asked me to make a presentation. Under 30 minutes, they said, wow, we like what you have presented. So let's sign a deal. So let's sign a deal. Well, we discussed how much it will cost and things like that. And immediately the following day, they get back to me. They said, we want you to actually start with us immediately. Wow. So how do I go? I can't leave here. I can't take my family. I can't take anything. So that's how I have to go for almost 2 months now. And then eventually make arrangements to bring up my family. And then immediately I got there, while I was going for the interview, the Lord was just ministering to me from Joshua chapter 1, verse 3. See, Joshua, the Lord told Joshua, he said, wherever the sole of your feet shall tread, I have given it to you. So when I landed at the airport, I said, God, I'm coming into this city, and I ask that the gate of this city be open for the gospel. So specifically, when I went in for the interview, all the questions they would ask me, the Holy Spirit told me before I got there. The Holy Spirit said, just talk about this, they will ask you about this, talk about this. And let me tell you, it was precise. So the door of the city was open for the gospel. And anytime I go in the train in the morning, I told God, I said, this city need to hear the gospel of God's grace. You know, I'm not saying there are not churches, but we are not talking churches here. We are talking the gospel. We are talking the gospel. And I believe that God is raising up leaders. He's raising up new people that he has trusted with his words that will take the gospel to the ends of the earth. So, to cut the long story short, so I'm still on the contract with the TD Bank, and my company is doing the project for them for the next almost 2 years now. So, but my wife and I, we have the plan to start our ministry right there by the grace of God. So we would confess your prayers and support as well. This is still our mother church by the grace of God. So we will always still call Pastor Kevin for support and advice as we go. So tonight, he asked me to preach, but you know, I didn't have any sermon notes. I didn't have even my laptop because I came to pack. So when they said they want me to preach, I can say, well, you know, if your pastor say you should preach, who are you to say you can't? That means I didn't do well in his class. I didn't have a sermon to preach. But I want to just encourage you tonight from Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6 is one of the most popular verses, but people really do not know what that chapter is all about. Ephesians chapter 6. You probably have heard it used in spiritual warfare. Verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having guarded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having sword your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all manners of prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Amen. So I want to speak briefly on the power of his might. The power of his might. You know, the instruction is that we should be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. The power of his might. The power of his might. You see, so Paul said we should be strong. Now the word strong is actually the same connotation for might. Okay, the word might is the same word for strength. Okay, if you have might, you have strength. Okay, he said be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You see, the strength of a believer is not in himself. The strength of a believer is in the Lord. The strength of a believer is not in himself. The strength of a believer is in the Lord. But he said we should be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So I want to talk a little bit about what this power is. The power of his might. You see, because I believe personally that in this end time, one of the areas that the devil deceives people is in the area of prayer. There are so many prayer centers that are open now doing deliverance, casting out devil, binding the enemy,
and doing deliverance for people, asking them to bring maybe some materials, handkerchief, bring some things as a medium for victory, for success. Some of them will even say they should bring money so that they can get some blessing or get some victory. You see, the church is presenting so many things that are going to end up making people lose. Because anything outside of the finished work of Christ is a recipe for failure. No matter how sound it is, no matter how logical it looks, if it is not based on the finished work of Christ, it won't hurt a fly. Because the enemy only recognizes the victory of the cross. So Paul said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now, but before we really understand this, it is interesting that we need to understand what happened in the cross first. Because before we get to chapter 6, where Paul said we should be strong in the Lord and we should put on the armor, he has actually talked to us about the power of God in the earlier chapters of the book of Ephesians. So if we look at Ephesians chapter 1, for example, chapter 1 of Ephesians, in verse, I think around 17, downward. Let's start from 15. He said, therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord, he's writing to the Ephesian church, and your love for all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayer, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power. I want you to take note of that. He's talking about the greatness of God's power. He said that power is exceedingly great. When you say something is exceedingly great, that means it's above any other power. It's above every other power. He said exceedingly greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. And if you get to chapter 2, he said, and you, he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sin, in which you were once walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Okay? So, if you look at the text that we read in chapter 1, what Paul was praying for the Ephesians church, is that the eyes of their understanding will be enlightened, so that they might know. He mentioned three things, but we are only interested in the third one. The third one is that they might know the greatness of God's power, which he wrought when he raised Jesus from the dead. So the starting point to spiritual warfare or to victory is to actually ask ourselves, what happened on the cross? Because until you know that, you have no basis for coming against principalities and powers. He said, so Paul pray. He said, I pray that your eyes will be open. Your eyes will be enlightened so that you might know the exceeding greatness of the power of God, which he wrought when he raised Jesus from the dead. And he set him above all principalities and power and dominion. So the first thing we know from that text is that Jesus defeated all principalities, powers, and dominions on the cross.
Yeah.
You see, many people are still praying, please God, help me defeat the devil. Please God, help me. No, it's a done deal. He's not going to do it. It's lack of knowledge of what has happened on the cross that made people to still continue to beg God to defeat one devil. No. According to this text, it is a finished work.
Yeah.
They are defeated. Principalities, powers, dominion, anything that is named in this world, they are under the feet of Jesus. And do you know that what he did was he raised us together with Christ. So where Jesus is sitting, that's where we are sitting. So the first thing that I think is important for us is to know our position as a believer. Is to know our position, that we are seated with Christ and we are above principalities, powers, dominion, and authority. So the first reality of the power of God in our life comes into effect with accurate knowledge of what Christ has already done. You can't walk in the power of God until you have the right kind of knowledge. In fact, Paul wrote about he wrote a letter to the Romans. In Romans chapter 10, he said, my people perish for lack of knowledge. He was talking about the fact that they have zeal for God, but it's not according to knowledge. He said, being ignorant of the righteousness of God, they are establishing their own righteousness, which is based on the law. So when people are ignorant of what happened on the cross, they begin to erect some pseudo-gods to give them victory. You know, there was an incident in Nigeria. One of the renowned pastor or man of God put his chair in the front, and he asked the church members to be marching to the front, and then they should touch the chair and go around if they want breakthrough and victory. That is idolatry. That is idolatry. That is ignorance of what Christ has already done. And you see, there are a lot of people in bondage today serving idols. And they put the name of God in it. Because anything that is not based on what Christ has already done is a pseudo God. And it's bound to fail because the enemy knows. The enemy know that, I mean, anything that you present to him outside of the blood of Jesus, it has no effect. That's why people continue to pray from day and night, and they see no effect of the prayer. Because it's not the length of the prayer that makes things work. It is the foundation on which you are standing that makes things work. You can go to all night vigils, you can go to all prayer meetings, if it's not found in what Christ has already done. And if some of you didn't know, I want you to just look at Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, because it gave us exactly the picture of what happened when Jesus died on the cross. He gave us a picture of how he dealt with principalities and powers. Colossians chapter 2 gave us that picture. That picture in verse 14, I think. From verse 13 downward, he said, and you being dead in your trespasses and uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all your trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirement that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Verse 15, he said, having disarmed, to disarm something means what? When you disarm somebody, it means you take the weapon of the person away. It means the person has no power. If you disarm him, he need the armor to be able to fight. But now if you disarm him, then he could not do anything. If you see a lion that is already disarmed, what happened? You say toothless, bulldog, he cannot do anything. So he said, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So he defeated them. And it's not a secret victory. The Bible says there was an open parade. He has an open parade. He triumphed. There was a triumphal procession. So that was what happened on the cross. On the cross, Jesus went to the grave. He defeated death. He conquered the grave. So that we might be free from the fear of death. He healed us from sicknesses by his stripes. That is what happened. We've got to have that knowledge. We've got to have it. Yeah. Because that's the foundation. Before you could deal with, put on the whole armor, no, knowledge first. You have to know it. If you don't know it, people will present an alternative God for you. I've seen several ridiculous things that people do in the name of Jesus. And it's time we begin to expand the real gospel that will set people free. Because the Bible says, you will know the truth, and the truth sets you free. I've seen several people that come in the name of God and ask people to be doing ridiculous things. There was a pastor in South Africa that asked people to be eating grass. And people were doing it. People were doing it. So we that know this gospel, we've got to preach it. Because the enemy is putting people in bondage to do things that are not godly in the name of Jesus. So the victory of the cross is something that we must know. That's the first one. The second thing that I think is important for us to walk in the power of his might is that we must know that the power of God dwells on the inside of us. Okay? That power that he's talking about, it's not an external power. So for example, if you look at me now, I don't have big body. I look small, right? So if a devil is judging me by the size of my look, he will say he will defeat me. But you see, you should go and ask Goliath. He made that terrible mistake because he thought it's by external look. He looked at Jacob, David, said, you this small boy. You came to me with just one small stone. He said, you know how many years I've been? And you see, Goliath was very tall. The Bible gave us all the description so that we know that by physique, he's really a huge guy. But David was just a small boy. So if you look at it from the outside, there's no way a David can defeat a Goliath. But because the power that we are talking about is not an outer power, it's an inner power. The might that we are talking about is on the inside of you. It's in your spirit. Mm-hmm. It's in your spirit. Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. I think from verse 14, Paul gave us that. He said, for this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened. You see, the word we are talking about, to be strengthened with might through his spirit. Where? In the inner man. In the inner man. So this might that we are talking about is an inward strength. So that's why people might look at you on the outside. You might not fit their profile of somebody that can succeed, of somebody that can win, of somebody that can make it. Because by all external appearances, you don't look like it. But God uses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. Okay? So when they look at you, you might be uneducated. You are not the best. You are not the wisest by world standard. But you see, that's what God wants to use. You remember when God chose David? When God asked Samuel to go and pick somebody to be the king, David was the unlikely candidate. He was not the choice. They assembled all the other seven, right? This other one will come. Samuel will say, oh, this one looked like the right one for the king. What did God say? No, I have not chosen him. He said, man, look at outward appearance, but I look at the heart. So the strength that I'm talking about is an inward strength. It's the strength that comes to you from your spirit, put in there by the Holy Spirit. The moment you have this knowledge that is described in chapter 1 of Ephesians, it translates to strength in your inner man. And what's one of the first signs that you will see when that strength is released is that you are no longer afraid. Number 2, you are also very bold. Can you imagine David, everybody for 40 days, They were afraid of Goliath. And this man, small boy, he didn't have a small fear in him. He looked at him and said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that is defiling the army of the Lord? Say, I will confront him.
Yeah.
Nobody dared does that. This guy was not even old enough to join the army. And he was talking tough. Goliath was talking, David was talking back. Nobody dared reply Goliath for 40 days. But you see, there is a boldness that comes to somebody who has received this might that makes them to talk tough. They are not talking tough because they have all the physique or external appearances, but they are talking tough because they are serving the Almighty God.
Yeah.
They are talking from the strength of the Almighty God. That's why Paul said this, we are not sufficient of ourselves to think of anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. That's why when you see a believer is not afraid, he's not afraid of any principalities, of any power, of any devil, because he knows that they are under his feet. So he can talk tough. He can talk bold. It's an inward strength. What is killing other people? What is destroying other people? You will just discover that there is something within you that rises up against it. That say, no, not me. No, not me. This sickness. No, not me. It has killed other people, but not me. Your body might be decaying, but you have strength that comes from the inside.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible says, if the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead, if it dwells inside of you, it will quicken your mortal body. Don't give in to sickness. Don't give in to failing. Don't give in to defeat, because you have something on the inside that powers you. You have one strength that people cannot understand. You know, Paul told Timothy, I think in 2 Timothy chapter 2, he said, be strong in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. There is a strength that you will receive that is not from this world. It comes from the Spirit. So Paul was praying there. He said, for this cause I bow my knee unto God, that he will grant you strength in your inner man. And I'm praying the same thing for you tonight. Maybe your strength is failing. Let me tell you, the way that God does impossible things is by releasing strength from our spirit. Anything you need from God, it begins from your spirit first. Mm-hmm. Anything that God will do, it started from inside out, not outside in. You remember Sarah? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 11, it said, even though Sarah was already past the age of bearing child, I think Hebrews 11, around verse 11 or 7. He said, even though she was already past the age of bearing child, medically speaking, biologically speaking, it's too late. But the Bible says she received strength to conceive. She received strength to conceive. This is not human power. This is not human strength. This is divine enablement. And it's coming to you right now too. Whatever you thought you cannot do, God said, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. My strength, God is not looking for experts by human standard. He's not looking for the best of human being. He's looking for people that he can put his strength in and work in. So that's the second part. So the first part is knowledge. Okay, you need to know what has already been done by Jesus. Number two, you need to know that the strength of his mind that we are talking about is inward. Okay, so don't say, oh, I'm not the kind of person that can hurt a fly. No. When Christ lives in you, you can cast out demons. You can lay hands on the sick. It's not about you. It's about who is inside. Okay, so don't let the enemy say, oh, no. When did you become a Christian? Yesterday. No, you don't have experience. Pastor Kevin can lay hands because he has been a Christian for all his life. No. It's not about how old you have been a Christian. It's about who is in you. The Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So it's an inward strength. The third thing I want to then bring to our attention is that the strength of his mind in Ephesians chapter 6, the strength of his mind must be put on at all times. You have to put it on. Even though Jesus did it, even though we know his inside strength, But you see, if you don't put it on, you can still go in defeat. We see many nice, wonderful Christians, but the enemy is terrorizing them. Because they are not putting on the weapon and the armor that they have been given. You see, Ephesians chapter 6 is now telling us how to now operationalize what has been given to us. He said, put on the armor. Put on the armor. You see, when you are confronting the enemy now, you are confronting the enemy with full armor. You remember when David was to go and confront Goliath, the first thing they have to settle is the armor.
Yeah.
Goliath was wearing an armor. He even had somebody that was dedicated as the armor bearer. That person stands in front of him anytime he's going to war. So he's as powerful as that, equipped physically. But now here is a David that doesn't have any armor. So Saul called him and said, come and put on my armor. But the Bible says it didn't fit him. It was too big. But you see, there is an armor that David had that nobody see. It's the armor of Christ. It's the armor of God. That's why anywhere you go to, you have to put yourself under the covering. Under the covering of the finished work of Christ. And he gave us what those armors are. He said, put on righteousness. Because you see, when the enemy comes and says, no, you are not good enough, you've got to put on your cap, righteousness. The debt was paid. And the righteousness of God, not because of what I've done. He said, put the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And the sword of the Spirit is when you put God's word into your mouth and you speak it out. Don't just keep quiet. Mm-hmm. The enemy is putting some thought in your mind and telling you that you are going to fail, you are not going to succeed, you are going to die, something is going to happen, some random useless thoughts in your mind. The Bible says we should cast out all those thoughts and put them in submission to Christ. So he said, no, I'm not going to die. I'm going to live. And you know what I found out is that some of the things that we don't even know, the enemy knows them. Mm. You know, I was reading this morning as I was sharing with my family. I've been doing a series on the generational blessing with my family for almost 3 weeks. Every day, I just write. So today, I wrote something on no one can curse who God has blessed.
Right.
That was the topic of what I wrote today. Numbers chapter 22 and 23. The story of Balak and Balaam. One of the things that struck me there when I read that text was the fact that Balak knows so much about the Israelites that he was afraid of them.
Yeah.
He heard of all the victories. He said, these people that came from Egypt, they are taking over every territory. And you know, Moab, where I'm the king, is a big city. If I give them the chance, they will take over my city. The Bible says he was afraid of them. And then the question that I was asking is, so if he's afraid of them, why didn't he go and gather his army and say we are going to confront them in war? Why did he have to go and look for a prophet that will curse them? Why? I mean, he should have just said, oh, since they are coming and they are taking over every territory, I'm going to assemble army to fight them. Why is he using a spiritual means? Why is he saying, the only thing I need to do is to curse them?
Right.
For them to suffer defeat? Because he understands the power of the blessing. That any time God blesses you, you are supposed to be walking in victory.
Wow.
So he said, if I can just remove the blessing and place a curse on their life, then they are defeated. So he was describing them to Balaam. And he said, no, if you can just curse them for me, I'll be okay. In fact, the Bible says, the first time, Balaam sent them back.
Yeah.
He sent another high-powered delegation to convince him. And then that time, God said he should go. But he said, whatever I put in your mouth, that's what you should say. The man could not curse them. And he made some statement that really challenged me to make me look at myself the way God sees me. Not the way my circumstances tell me, the way God sees me. Because for me, if the enemy know that much about who I am, if the enemy is so afraid of me because of the blessing that he knows is operating in my life, wow, it means I must be of great value than the way I've been looking at myself. Because we are still afraid of the same enemy that is afraid of us.
Yeah.
The enemy is running away because of you, he's panicking because of you, but because you don't know, you still allow the enemy to be threatening you. So the enemy knows. The enemy knows that the moment you put in the hammer, they cannot stand you. Because Paul says, when we put on that armor, we'll be able to withstand every wise of the enemy. We'll be able to defeat every principalities and powers. We'll be able to put them where they belong. But the question is, are we putting on the armor? He said we should put the belt of truth. You see, everything that he mentioned in the armor are the product of the finished work of Christ. Yeah. Everything. Everything. You see, people say, oh, I'm doing spiritual warfare. I'm doing spiritual. But what is it based on? Nothing that they are claiming in those prayers is based on what Christ did. Nothing. For me, it's just gym. They are just doing gymnastic. After 1 hour of prayer, you will feel you have done some exercise. And you go home and the devil threatens you again. And you run back to the prayer center. But if you see somebody who God is lying with the belt of truth, because one of the weapons that the enemy uses is lie.
Yeah.
It tells you lie. So when you guard yourself with the belt of truth, no lie can stand it. So finally, the text says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You see, God is more powerful than you can ever think about, than you can ever imagine him. Okay, in Ephesians chapter 3, if you read it further, it said to him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you can think of imagining, because of his power that is at work in us. So I don't know what you might be confronting, what you might be going through, but I'm telling you, there is a power that is above that particular thing.
Yeah.
There is a power that works in you that can put you over and above that thing. But it starts with you first changing your belief systems and what you know about Christ and what has happened. If you are looking to God for healing in your body, the first place to do is to know that by his stripes you have been healed.
That's right.
Okay? And then the second thing that you need to then do is say, Lord, even though my flesh might be failing, but I want you to increase my inner strength. Give me strength from the inside. Give me strength. Because when the Spirit of Christ lives in you, it revitalizes the body. It supplies strength to the body. It supplies nutrients to the body. And the third thing is, anytime the enemy brings thoughts or attack you in your mind, put it on. Put it on. Put the armor on. You see, many of us, when it's snowing outside, you know how to dress well, right? For the snow. If you don't dress well for the snow, will you blame government when you are beaten by the snow? No. Because you have your shoes, you have your jacket, you dress adequately for the weather. So the same instruction Paul is saying, put it on. The same way you wear your shoes, the same way you wear your clothes, put it on. And anytime you see put it on in the Bible, actually, he's talking about dressing your mind. He's talking about the mind. Dressing your mind correctly. Correctly, when you are going out. Don't forget that you are righteous. Don't forget the truths that you have learned in the world. Don't forget to put God's word in your mouth and speak it out. That's what he's saying. He said, with that, you will be able to quench every fiery dart of the enemy. I want us to pray together as we rise up tonight. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You know, one of the songs that we sang says, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. You know, when we worship, what we are doing is we are magnifying God in our imagination. Now, God doesn't change in size, but you see, situations make God shrink. When we look at our situation, sometimes God looks small. But when we begin to worship, what it does is God is magnified in our imagination. So worship makes us big in our imagination. Yeah. So that's why when we sing, we are not in a party club, just having fun or entertaining. No, worship is a spiritual thing. When we worship God, your problem shrinks and God is magnified. Yeah. That's why one of the first key that we can take from David is that in the high of everybody, in the high of Goliath, he magnified God and he make Goliath look small than he has been. He said, who is this guy? He said, before the host of God, I will bring you down. He didn't keep quiet. So tonight I want you to also know that whatever you are going through, as we rise up and pray this evening, they will disappear. They will disappear. And strength will be released into your life. Strength will be released. Things that you thought you could not do, from tonight, you will start doing.